my sweet little noodles. My name is Brittany and welcome back to my channel. Today, we're going to be comparing six books against their screen adaptations.
It's Brittany, bitch.
Now, this is a video series that I've wanted to do for a very long time. I think I've had it on my video idea list for probably about 2.5 to 3 years, perhaps. And I've been on BookTube for about 4 coming up here. So it's been a long time in the making. As I already stated, I'll be comparing 6 books against their screen adaptations. So to qualify for these, I had to have read the books and I also had to see the screen adaptation. Now these can be movies and or TV shows. So they can be limited series, ongoing series, it doesn't really matter. But I had to have read the source material and I had to watch the movie and or the TV show. And I'm gonna give you my personal recommendation into what is better. So first up we have The Handmaid's Tale. Now I read this book back in 2019 and I gave it 4 stars. Now I'd be really surprised if you hadn't heard about this yet because the book series is very popular, as is the Hulu TV series. The Handmaid's Tale is all about a future dystopian society in which people are basically infertile. Fertility rates are so low that we can no longer populate our world. So to save humanity and to solve that problem, right-wing nutters decide to create this beautiful land called Gilead, which is like smack dab in the US. I think it's like Illinois or something. I'm not 100% sure on that. I don't remember. But they decide to go ahead and create this society in order to breed human beings. So women who are handmaids who wear the color red, they are women who are not barren. I guess they have the chance of conceiving a child, and they are paired up with a commander and his wife. So the wife is a barren woman of wonderful societal standing, and she's married to the commander, and the commander and her have a ceremony once a month in which the commander tries to make a child with the handmaid. And this is a really weird religious alt-right future, and it's honestly terrifying. Not only do I see comparisons between our current society and this society, but it honestly feels like something that could happen. It's also a perfect example of how unchecked, unadulterated power can corrupt people and corrupt societies and literally ruin people's lives and start wars. It is a very intense series, so I would go into that knowing such. I would definitely recommend looking up the trigger warnings for this. And in the book and in the show, we are following Offred, who is played by Elizabeth Moss. Now, The Handmaid's Tale in the show is pretty much the same as the book. It is very, very similar, except that The Handmaid's Tale now has multiple seasons and it definitely embosses on the original story. I think the original story is very important and I definitely would recommend it. But if you're just going for an experience, I would recommend the show. It is very, very intense though. So again, please go into it with a good headspace and knowing what's going to happen and what happens to these women and the amount of trauma that is in this society. It is terrifying and yet encapsulating. So definitely buckle up and be prepared to be traumatized yourself. I am partial to the Hulu series, but past season 3, I'm not as much of a fan of it for some reason. I don't really like the way that they took Offred's character. I don't like the choices that she made. So I'm not as big of a fan of the show as I used to be. But the first, I think 2 or 3 seasons are just absolutely stunning and they're very close to the books. There's also a second book in the series called The Testaments, which I did read, and it follows people outside of Gilead as well. I definitely would give that a read, but I think you only need to read the first one if you just want to understand this world. So to sum it up, would definitely recommend the book, but I think if you're just looking for that fix, watch a TV show. Next up is the very famous book and TV series, You. Now, You is also a Netflix TV series, and Joe Goldberg is played by none other than Penn Badgley. Penn himself has like a lot of Scorpio placements, and I feel like he was the perfect pick for Joe Goldberg. Joe in the book and in the TV show is totally unhinged. This man is deplorable, but especially in the book, we get to see his firsthand accounts of how he thinks about women. And in the first season and then in the first book, that obsession is Beck. She is like a young student in New York who is struggling of her own accords of being a student in New York, not being able to pay rent and having daddy issues. And Joe is just obsessed with her. And he had a troubled past himself. And the whole book is told in second person. So he's constantly talking to her. He's constantly like, you're doing this. You're doing this. You did this to me. He is definitely a lot more scary, I think, in the book, because in the TV show, they do change a lot and they make him more of a likable character. And in my personal opinion, the TV show did it better. You as a TV show is so freaking good. I rewatched it multiple times. I rewatched all the seasons multiple times, except for the newest season, which is season 4, which just dropped this year. And the last and final season, season 5, is coming next year. So it's going to eventually wrap up. But I will note that the books, because there are 3, and the TV show are completely different. They have very different storylines. storylines, even if they did have some similar characters in the first and second books. I'm not sure about book three because I haven't read book three because I wasn't completely interested. I just would prefer the TV show. Should you read the book? I mean, why not? I think you definitely could. I read the book after I watched the show and I still enjoyed it, but I only gave it 3 stars. The TV show is a must watch. It is a rewatch. It is probably one of my favorite series just because it is so interesting. Every single time I notice something different. So for me, the winner is the TV show. Next up is Little Fires Everywhere, which I think I read in 2019 or 2020. And I didn't love the book. I only gave this 3 stars. It is a literary fiction about family drama, town drama. Honestly, I think the book is well done. I don't think literary fiction is necessarily my jam, but my biggest issue was the main driving force of this novel was this familial relationship between Mia and her child and why she's on the run with her child all the time. To me, it wasn't necessary. I'm not going to spoil the whole thing for you. If you want, go ahead and check out my review on Goodreads where I do spoil that issue and it's in a little spoiler box, but it was very frustrating to read about. And I feel like the entire book basically could have been scrapped if Mia had not done something. And Mia is still an unlikable character in the limited Hulu TV series, but I think that the Hulu series definitely did this book better. The TV series 100% gets my vote because it not only has Reese Witherspoon, but it really just brought the characters to life. I think especially in some formats, drama and such is played out better. And I think that TV shows are definitely a better way to flesh out characters because a lot of the characters in the book just didn't really feel, not necessarily like people, but they weren't very fleshed out and I didn't really care. I felt always very detached from what was happening. And I don't know if that was just the writing style or what. I think it's also a big part of literary fiction is always feeling like you're on the outside looking in at people. And I kind of like that, but it's also hard for me to care, especially when I don't already like a lot of the characters and their decisions. So the TV series for me was the way to go. And the TV series ended up changing the ending from the book. So I think in a lot of ways it worked better. But again, I still do not always love these characters. But 100%, I'm gonna go with the TV show for this one. Now the next book and screen adaptation I'm gonna talk about may be kind of a shocking opinion, but I'm gonna talk about The One by John Mars. And I read this book, I believe, also back in 2020, and I didn't love it. Also gave it 3 stars. But this book is essentially a sci-fi thriller that is about this genetic matching system that can match you with your soulmate with a 99.97% accuracy. A lot of people describe this to me as Black Mirror, and I guess in a lot of ways it did feel that way, but it really felt more like a dramatic contemporary. It didn't have the sci-fi thriller aspect I was looking for. Now, there is a perspective in the book specifically from a serial killer who is matched up. And I think that's why the book was so popular at this time and was just so intriguing to read because those were the most interesting chapters. The fact that, of course, it's matching people up with some genetic capability, but the fact that like you're matching up a serial killer just it brings up so many morality issues and so many ethic issues about this kind of a program. The biggest frustration for me was the lack of scientific evidence, the lack of like lab work we really got to see, because like with that successful program, I kind of wanted to see more of that. Like it was a really interesting part of the book that you're that accurate in finding someone's soulmate, yet more people aren't using it. I also feel like that would have been more interesting to see, but there definitely were some really cool perspectives in here. But of course, the serial killer one was the most interesting, and then this book ended with a bang. Now, on to the TV show that was on Netflix. I have never had a TV show butcher a book so badly. I even went back to my review on Goodreads and updated the fact that the show had completely ruined the book. I would never, under any circumstances, recommend the TV show. The TV show completely takes out the serial killer perspective and adds in so many other things that nobody cares about. And I think that's why it debuted on Netflix and then like instantly like just faded away. Nobody has ever talked about it ever since. Like I've literally never heard one booktuber talk about it ever since they watched it and were like, wow, that was awful. Awful. So for this one, the book is 100% gonna win out. The next one I'm gonna talk about is 11/22/63 by Stephen King. This is a very, very large fiction book. Now this book is all about a man named Jake going back in time to save JFK from being assassinated. So he finds like this little wormhole to go back to the 50s. And I think my favorite part of this entire book was just like the amount of things that he described were better in the 50s. Like the food tasted better, the air smelled better. It was a very visceral book and a very visceral feeling, and you just feel like you're there with him the entire time. And it is really fascinating to see how engrossed he gets in people's lives. He's basically coming from modern day into the past, and he's trying to change JFK from being being assassinated. And a lot of those stakeouts with him were pretty boring, I'm not gonna lie. And it's a very long book. I think it's well over 800 pages. But the parts where he is working at a school and he falls in love with Sadie, who is a librarian at said school, it's a really beautiful book. It really makes me cry. The ending makes me cry every single time. And so does the TV show that features James Franco. And my only issue with James Franco on the TV show is that he's not very tall. And in the book, Jake was like so tall, he was like constantly being looked at. He was like 6'5" or something, and people like were gawking at him all the time. And that also made it more difficult for him to like stake out of Lee Harvey Oswald and try to get like this whole situation stopped. So it's very thrillery, I think, in the book and the TV series. You don't feel as much of the tension till the very end. So for that, I'm going to recommend the book. The book 100% wins. You get so much more with it, but it is very, very long. And if you're not a Stephen King fan, I'm just gonna recommend the TV show. The TV show is pretty short. They do a great job with it. I think it's really, really well done. And they don't really skip too much from the book. The book and the TV show are very well matched and they're very well paired. So I wouldn't worry about losing too much information. My biggest gripe really was just that James Franco was not tall. And that's a whole big thing in the book because Jake has a much harder time sleuthing about. So this was a pretty close tie. I wouldn't be mad if you decided to do either one, but for this one, I'm gonna vote the book. I'm gonna vote the show as well. So do what you will with that. Last and certainly not least is Ready Player One. Now I read this book, I believe back in 2022, and I did end up seeing the movie like many years prior and just didn't really think anything about it. The book is all about Wade Watts, who is a teenager in an Oklahoma City trailer park in 2044. So it is the future, it is dystopian, it's a hot mess. And the only oasis from their lives is the Oasis. It is a virtual reality that is available to everybody. And the creator of the Oasis died and left behind an Easter egg, AKA his giant ass fortune. So if you find the Easter egg, you win the fortune and you control the Oasis. So it starts this whole slew of games and trials in order to find the Easter egg. Now, this is a fantastic premise and the book was really interesting and I loved all the 80s references because it is set in the 80s because that is where the creator grew up, was in the 80s. So the 80s was very abundant in this, and if you were growing up in the 80s, I'm sure you would definitely appreciate that. Even for my taste as someone who loves the 80s, it was a little dense on the 80s references. And I think the most frustrating part of this was there was definitely some, I would say like 80s conservative mindset that was very present in this book. Wade meets someone online that he really loves called Artemis, and he talks to her all the time, and he's deathly afraid that she is an obese man living in his mother's basement. And that was just a very apparent theme, and it was very I don't know, like fat phobic. I can't really go into too much, but that was definitely an omnipresent issue for me in the book. Now for the movie, they changed a lot of it, in my opinion. They changed a lot of the trials. I think the trials in the book were a lot better. The trials in the movie, I guess, were like very stunning and they were like cool CGI and stuff, but the book definitely felt deeper. I think a lot of times the screen adaptation can really flesh out characters and make books better, but in this case, the book wins hands down. Like the movie just cannot reach the depth that the book had. And in the movie, it just felt like another blockbuster for us to enjoy. It didn't really have the same stakes. I didn't feel everything as much, but it was cool to see, you know, what they envisioned for a lot of things. But I do think that the book definitely did this one better. So for Ready Player One, it's definitely gonna be the book, honey. All right, that is all 6 books and the 6 screen adaptations. Now this is just volume 1 out of many volumes, so I do have other videos planned for this and I'm constantly adding to them. So when I finish a book that I know has a screen adaptation, I'm trying to add to the list and then watch that screen adaptation as soon as possible. So I'm gonna try to get these out hopefully in the next year or so. It's taken only about 3 years to get to this point, but I'm gonna try my best to get volume 2 out within the next 2 months or so. If there is a book or a screen adaptation you guys would like me to talk about in volume 2, please go ahead and drop it down below. I hope you guys have a wonderful day. Talk to you guys soon.